session chairman, ladies and gentlemen. It's my great privilege to be here sharing some of the thoughts on the Lean Six Sigma. The topic has been given is making customer delight, as session chairman rightly mentioned. It's one of the toughest job every industry is going through. I have chosen to share with you two approaches, one from manufacturing and one from the global rollout on the service industry. Because the Lean and Six Sigma came from two different disciplines. Probably the Lean is a younger, elder brother of Six Sigma, because it's more than 5 decades old. And in the over the last 10 years of my association in the industry, what I'm noticing is the fusion between the Lean and Six Sigma is yet to take place. So I've taken two case studies which I wanted to share with you. Primarily, I will be walking through a manufacturing application of Lean Six Sigma, and then a global rollout on a service industry. That is what the agenda I have chosen to speak to you. Of course, enough has been said since morning. The problems that are being faced in the globalized scenario, where the delivery time and zero defect and manufacturing cost is going up, and product variety is becoming a problem for every industry to face. And if you look at the service industry business models, the primary issues are customer focused service processes. That's one of the issues most of the service industries are facing, and customer relations. So unlike the manufacturing model, in a service model, the customer dissatisfaction is very imminent because people directly interact with the customers. So currently what's happening is the need to do capability of organizations. If you look at the quality, cost, delivery and service expectations over the last 15 years or so, as going through a dramatic change, challenging almost all the do capabilities of the organization. The need has been dramatically moving, unlike what it was in the pre-globalization scenario. So there are lots of substitutes on the products which are also challenging the organizations, pushing them out of business. That's what we have been witnessing in the last 10 years. Having said that, I just want to give you a flavor of a manufacturing application of a Lean Six Sigma. One of the strategic issues this organization was facing is taking a single component of a cylinder. Many of you may be aware that in the flexible packaging industry, they make cylinders which are being used for printing the flexible packaging. So this industry felt that supplying these cylinders in the multicolor is the biggest challenge, and part of the supplies take place and the customers are not in a position to use those products for their application. They felt that making this available to the customer is making the elephant to dance. So some of the primary objectives this organization has chosen is to delight the customer by delivering them the right quantity of cylinders which are full set. So the focus was on-time delivery in full quantity. So if you are not supplying even one cylinder, the customer may not be in a position to use that. So they called it as OTIF as one of the objectives. Increase the productivity. Obviously, they have been using only 60 to 70% of their capacity, and reduce the rejection and inventories of their manufacturing line. These are the strategic objectives of this application of Lean Six Sigma project. A very elaborate Lean charter has been made just to focus your attention on some of the selected areas of improvement is significantly doubling the performance which are delivering full quantity and increasing the throughput, improving the productivity and reducing the inventory. So this has been the objective that has been chosen. If you look at the value stream map, or ASCII's value stream map, which was done in iGraphics, you notice this complex information flow that is taking place right from the time the order is received and it is being processed and the raw material is made available. It has been a very tedious kind of information flow. There's a push system, obviously, like any manufacturing companies today has got a push system that everybody does their job, and ultimately they are not in a position to supply the material to the customer on time. If you look at the lean performance indicators in terms of the lead time, it's 118 hours, and process cycle efficiency, which is an indicator of the value added activity over the total lead time, is only 6%. Within 6% of the time is the only time when there is an actual value addition takes place in the product. The first time right, the rolled throughput yield is only 73%. That means the number of items which have passed through all the manufacturing stages with zero defect is only 73%. Rest of them go through repetitive rejections and rework in the manufacturing. So some of the important diagnoses which are lean detractors, if you really like to call them, a long lead time from the time order is received and the raw material is available in the shop floor. Defects in the manufacturing, obviously they put them back into the manufacturing steps once again. And there is a significant design lead time. In these type of industries, there is a design process involved in every particular printing taken for a flexible packaging. So there is a lot of lead time which is consumed in terms of making these designs available. And batch processing, of course, causes underutilization of the resources. From the lean value stream map, they have identified certain areas where Six Sigma can be applied. I just want to give you a flavor of how the Six Sigma runs along with the lean initiatives. As you have seen in the example, that the lean value stream map defines the overall workflow issues, and then the Six Sigma projects are chosen. As you could see from this indicators, that most of the manufacturing steps there is a significant rejection and reworks do happen. Looking at the non-manufacturing processes, the projects are covering almost every conceivable information flow in the whole value chain, trying to challenge the various time taken for each one of those processes. If you look at the total time that is consumed in most of these processes, as you could see, there is a 50% reduction in the processing time across the value chain, which gives you an idea that lean is not only a manufacturing system improvement, it is something to start from the order to delivery, how we look at the various processes. So the future state value stream map, as you could see, there is a pacemaker. The marketing has been made as the pacemaker. Such as those who have applied lean will appreciate that someone in the value chain initiates and manages the whole workflow. So marketing has taken in this case as the pacemaker, and there is a kitting process which is ensuring that a full quantity of cylinders are being fed to the manufacturing line. And the whole system has become a full system, using the FIFO methodology, which is essentially the characteristics of the pull system. So one interesting characteristics of this application is the Kanban are usually the cards, but this organization has chosen to use a computer system, which is a homegrown software, by which you will be able to figure out at what stage a particular order is being executed. So even a marketing guy will be able to answer to the customer that what particular station in which the product is being produced. So if you look at the overall improvement, the production quantity, productivity, which is measured at 120 cylinders per day, without increasing in capital investment, it will improve to 200 cylinders. The rolled throughput yield, which is an indicator of the quality characteristics of the manufacturing process, which was 73%, this whole application of Lean and Six Sigma together has taken them to 91%. So that gives you an idea of how the Lean and Six Sigma can run parallelly in challenging a manufacturing system. In terms of the application of the tool, probably Lean, Six Sigma, and IT, business process re-engineering, scorecards, and the tools are not the most important aspect. It is how they have been applied for solving a typical manufacturing problem. So having said that, I just want to give you a glimpse of how the Lean Six Sigma is being applied for a large-scale multinational rollout. This is an organization which is in a logistics business present in 252 countries. Had a serious problem of meeting the customer expectation. The touchpoint experience of the customer has not been satisfactory. Just to give you an idea, the strategic levers have been kept. The objective is to make the customer to fall in love with their organization. So they felt the customer loyalty is the only thing which will increase your organic growth of the organization. If you look at the concept which is being applied, there are three strategic levers. One is making the customer insight, that put yourself in the shoes of the customer. And use the DMIC as the back-end engine, Lean and Six Sigma as the back-end engine. Because some of the problem many organizations are facing is saying that we are doing Six Sigma, and people feel that Six Sigma is, we are not ready for applying Six Sigma. So when you are talking about the business issue as the focal point, and Six Sigma becomes the back-end engine. And thirdly, the execution is based on, which is shown here, that the top management will place a supportive role, and enrolling the people across the organization is the strategic intention. So challenging all the business processes which are giving you a different kind of a customer experience are put under microscope. So essentially, if you look at the kind of results that the service model is looking at, getting closer to the customer and try to understand what is their expectation, enrolling the people, and using the DMIC as more as a systematic problem solving tool rather than end by itself. So based on these two experiences, I just before I could conclude, one of the disadvantages I noticed in organization taking a tool based application of organizational intervention, it does not get into the DNA of the organization, because most of them are consultant driven. The moment consultant disappears, these initiatives also die down. And there is no government's structure available to manage continuous improvement as a way of life. And most of these improvements are voluntary, and then people have got the question, what is there in it for me? And as long as they are not integrated with the people related processes, they don't stick with the organizations in the long run. What I wanted to suggest is, as you could see, this is showing that organizations which don't have a vision and direction, people pull in their own direction. So what I wanted to suggest is that we align the whole organization, not only by doing certain improvement project for a short period of time, but how we are trying to create an integrated strategy management system, which will translate the boardroom issues in terms of the shop floor problems, and then we address them. Because most of the problems that are taken for improvement are all bottom up in most of the organization. Sometimes they don't address the realistic strategic issues of the company. And the management wants to know where is the money. So as I have been seeing this morning, that the amount of focus that's coming through in terms of measuring the financial gain is becoming more and more important. So how do we translate the business goal into a program management, and then finally relate with the key performance indicators of the organization, is what I wanted to propose. And then it becomes a more of a internally driven organizational continuous improvement program, and not depending on external resources for a pretty long time. So there's a combination of top-down strategy being managed through various programs in the organization, and the bottom-up improvement taking place, and then people have clear accountability in terms of doing what they are really expected to do. Thank you very much. That's all I wanted to say. Thanks for giving this opportunity.